Good morning.
Good morning.
It was almost feeling like it was warm yesterday at 30 degrees. I thought, wow, this is wonderful. And I talked to a friend down in the Jackson area, and they said they had 55 degrees and mud. 8 inches of snow melted in one day and has created new fishing ponds and mud. So I said, I guess I'm glad I'm up here because I'd be walking in the mud. Things that are taking place, most of the things this week are just normal, except for Wednesday, we begin the season of Lent, and I invite you to open up your bulletin and pull out the insert that is there. Now, I want you to take a look at this for a second so that you can follow if you didn't, just so you know what is here, and that is the season of Lent is going to be focused in a series called When Your Faith is Chained Down. And we are going to be talking about what happens when our faith is burdened by the things of the world and in our lives. And I invite you to follow along. Now, in this, the scripture for each week is here with the sermon title, so you can try and figure out how it connects. In fact, I would invite you to read it ahead of time, simply so that you have a clue what's going on. The two Bible studies, the virtual and the Thursday afternoon, those two are going to be studying the passages each week. Wednesday night is Ash Wednesday. It is going to be in the chapel, and it will be an integral part of the sermon series on what happens when our faith is chained down. And why does it get there? So I would invite you to come and participate in that. There will be the imposition of ashes and communion. And so we will offer that this week. I think you'll be intrigued, and I hope that you will participate in When Your Faith is Chained Down. Let's stand. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning, God.
Good morning, God.
Thank you for letting us worship and praise your name. Gracious and heavenly God, we give you thanks for this day as we come on a Sunday that is known as Transfiguration Sunday. Sunday when? When Jesus took Peter and James and John up to the top of the mountain, and they saw your presence there in the cloud. And they decided they wanted to stay there. But Jesus said, we got to go back down to work. And so we come this day and pray that as we come, we can experience that mountaintop moment, as well as feel that need to go down the mountain to get back to work. We pray, O Lord, your blessing upon this service through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Rest in the perishing care for wonderful purpose, but boy, it's nice to see you guys' faces. And if you're wearing a mask, no worries. I still wear one a lot also, so it's good to have you all here today. My name is Pam Olgren, and I am your liturgist today. So please join me in the call to worship, following along in your bulletin or on the screen, or if you're online, you can listen. How shall we worship our God?
We have heard what the Lord requires of us. Leave empty talk and pride behind.
We must walk the walk. Prepare to step out in faith, even into troubled waters.
Only God knows where we might need to go. Don't be afraid.
Jesus will guide our steps along the way, teaching us to walk humbly and to love boldly.
Let us pray for the humility and courage to follow where the Spirit leads.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good. Yeah.
Open. Dear Lord, your forgiveness is total. You take our confession, offered with hands outstretched and gently, like the loving Heavenly Father that you are, put it to one side to be forgotten. No grudges, no itching for judgment, no resentment or ill will. Not like us, who find it easy to say sorry, but so hard to forgive. Forgive us, Father, that we are often more willing to accept forgiveness than to forgive. More willing to accept your love than to share it with those who've hurt us. Teach us to forgive as you forgive. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our scripture readings today, Pastor Bob chose two scriptures. They're both from the book of James. The first one comes from the book of James, chapter 4, verses 11 through 12. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters. Whoever speaks evil against another or judges another speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver and judge who is able to save and to destroy. So who then are you to judge your neighbor? And the second is from chapter 5 in the book of James, verses 7 through 12. Be patient, therefore, beloved, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious crop from the earth, being patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is nearby. Beloved, do not grumble against one another, so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. As an example of suffering and patience, beloved, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Indeed, we call blessed those who showed endurance. You have heard of the endurance of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. Above all, my beloved, do not swear, either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes, and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. Thanks be to God.
The moment we've all waited for, you've been waiting for it, haven't you, Homer? Here is America's favorite judge, the Right Honorable Samuel Davis Jr.
You can testify, but you just can't win, because I'm here to tell you you're guilty of sin. Here comes the judge.
Right Honorable Samuel Davis Jr. presiding.
Do your thing.
Your Honor, I'm pleading innocent to this burglary rap.
Well, I think I got you because you forgot about one important visual defect in your case.
What's a visual defect?
Somebody saw you doing it.
And that's proven a natural.
I find you guilty of sneaking up behind the late Mr. Walters and stabbing him in the back.
But, come here. If I hadn't seen, he would have caught you with his wife.
Due to extenuating circumstances, I reduced the charge to following too closely. 30 days suspended sentence. You are free to leave the courtroom anytime you want.
Bless you.
You really do like me, though.
You're mean, but you like me, right?
Do you pray after that or before that? Lord, let your word speak to us. Let these words, O Lord, be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, Sammy Davis Jr. and the laughing crew took the comedy of a man named Pig Meat Markham, an African-American comedian who was making the circuit just before that time with the theme of Here Come the Judge. And they did a pretty good job with it over the years and making us think about it. But one of the most interesting things that we need to think about with that, or one of the ironic things, is that when we look in the mirror, so often we should start singing, Here Come the Judge, Here Come the Judge, Here Come the Judge, Here Come the Judge. Because have you ever noticed how often it is that we begin to look at other people and we begin to look at what they have as wrong in their life as compared to what we think we have as right? Have you ever noticed how easy it is for us to come up with issues against somebody else instead of looking at ourselves first? You see, James was working in the early church, and the early church did not change a whole lot till today. In fact, I am sure that during the time that I have been a pastor in 40 years, that I have seen at least, I don't know how many times, that I've heard the people from the congregations judging other people in the congregations just the way that James did. Finding that there were those who were supposed to be the ones that were welcomed in and those who were the ones who were supposed to be issued out. Those who were supposed to be brought into the fold and those who were supposed to be kept at a distance. And the issue that James was talking about, because James was dealing with a real church in real time, about 20 years or so after Jesus' death and resurrection. So it didn't take long for that backbiting to start happening. And as we talked about last week, we need to listen more than we speak. And the problem is that so often what comes out of our mouth when we can't tame our tongue is that we use the spirit of judgmentalism. To name and view those who are near us. If they're not the same as us, well, then they're not right. If they're not just like us, then they're not right. If they don't dress like us, then they're not right. If they don't smell like us, maybe they are right. But you know, the reality is that our lives are caught in our nature, and our nature is self-centeredness, and our nature is, because it is self-centered, it is sinful, because whenever we look to ourselves first and look at how we want to feel better about ourselves rather than how we can first look through God's eyes, then when we live that out, that is the nature of sin. Now, James says it like this: do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters. Whoever speaks evil against another or judges another speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but judge. There is one lawgiver and judge who is able to save and to destroy. So who then are you to judge your neighbor? See, James was dealing with that in the church, and he was trying to help them understand that we need to be looking at each other and seeing what God has given each other, to grace each other, to raise each other up, James is wanting the folks to look at others in the eye and not see what they did wrong, but to see what they are doing that is good and right. But that's hard. That's hard because in our world we're taught the only way to the top is to step on the fingers of the people on the ladder below us. The only way to climb that mountain is to knock the dirt down so others can't make their way. But you know, one of the things that we find is that when we listen to the message of Jesus, he says, we were not here to be served, but we were sent to serve. We're not here to be the first, but we're here to be the last. We're not here to be the one who owns the slaves, but we're the ones to become the slaves so that we can serve others, because the first will be last and the last will be first. And yet, our minds flip it over and say, look at what's wrong with you. That James was sharing what I'm sure he heard his brother Jesus say. I'm sure that James heard it at least once or twice in Jesus' ministry when he spoke these words in the Gospel of Matthew. Do not judge so that you may not be judged. That's a hard thing to do, but you know, that makes us question that. But so often, I was reading one article about that, it said, so often we read the first half of that sentence and never go any further. Do not judge. And we use that when we are doing something that we want to do and somebody else is judging us. And we say, Jesus said, do not judge. Jesus didn't stop there. He said, do not judge lest you be judged. And then he continues on. For with the judgment that you make, you will be judged. And the measure which you give will be the measure which you get. I want you to think about that for a moment. Whenever we are judging somebody about who they are, what they are, what they're doing, whether they're doing it right, whether they're doing it wrong, whether they're climbing the right direction, whether they're going in the right place, whatever they are doing, we are being judged by that same thing. It's like we're looking in the mirror because they're thinking the very same thing about us. And the only thing that we can do on that is turn it upside down, turn it around like we do when we start to follow Jesus, because when we do it, it's a 180-degree turn, or it's an upside down, and we look at it backwards, and we look and we go, thank you for doing what you're doing. How can I help you with the tasks that you have at hand? And instead of looking and saying, you know, as you were hammering that nail, you bent three of them before you got one in straight. Yeah, I do that regularly. But what if we were to say, you know what, let me help you get those bad nails out so that they're out of your way, so that you can hit them straight the next time. You know what? And as you practice that, it gets better. You only, the next time you do a project, you may only have two bent nails out of four. And the next time it may only be one out of four. And then it may be you get them all. Or every once in a while, it doesn't matter how good you are. After having worked with carpenters for 4 years when I was in college, I learned that even the carpenters don't get them all straight. And then Dan, the foreman, he goes, "Now I want you to know something. Don't ever go to the carnival and try and play that game where they put the nails in and they say, if you can hammer that in without bending it, you'll win the prize." He says, "Because they always start them crooked, and even if they look like they're straight, they'll be crooked, and you won't be able to knock it in unless you have the eye of a carpenter." And then he pulled out a piece of 2x4, and he put some nails in, and he goes, try and drive those in. All of them bent or popped out. And he goes, "Okay, now you start them." It's one of the few times I was allowed as a non-union errand boy, which is basically what I was, carpenter's helper, got to pick up a hammer other than when I was carrying tools to another part of the site. And he said, "Now you start the nails and you drive them in." And I got all four of the nails to go in straight because I started them on the angle that I could drive them. You see, we're each at a different angle. We're each at a different slope in our lives. I was watching, I hate to say this, but I was watching our worship service while I was in the hospital. I was watching some of the ones from the fall when I was preaching, and I was watching, and one of the things I noticed was that I tip over when I'm walking. I have a tilt or a lilt or something. And then I remembered, I forgot to put the lifts in my new shoes. After I got my knee done, my left leg is now a half inch longer than my right one, because my right one is so bowed that when I go to stand up, I can't stand straight. And so when I walk, if I don't have a lift in my shoe, I'm tipped over. And you know what? It really feels a lot better when I get myself even. But if I'm looking at somebody else and looking at their tilt, I'm always going to see them as different than me. And I'm going to judge them as different and say, you know, you're not quite right. I can tell you what, as I was watching those videos, I found out something really clear. I'm not quite right. And people have been trying to tell me that for years, but I hadn't really understood. And maybe that's not what they meant. Some people were telling me, you know, you're not quite right. And I'm going, am I wrong? That's not what we mean. Okay. And so when we listen to that, we have to be aware of the fact that when we go to judge somebody, we have to listen not only to James saying, do not judge, but we have to listen to the reason behind it. And Jesus continued that very statement with, why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not see the log in your own eye? You know, it's a matter of perspective. But the speck that's in my eye can really be a log, but I don't think it's much. I'm not so bad. I've had people tell me, you know, I'm not too worried about getting into heaven because I'm a good person. I'm not so bad. You ever heard anybody say that to you? Yeah, I'm not so bad. I'm not going to make it. Well, the problem is none of us are going to make it on our own. Because we all have a tilt, we all have a little, we all have a brokenness, we all have sinfulness. And it takes the power of God's love through his son, Jesus Christ, to enter that gate. And if we're going to judge others, we've got to remember we have to first look at ourselves. Look at ourselves in the mirror. Look and see what's not right. One of the articles, I think, was speaking directly to me that I read this week. And the guy said, you know, I was reading about this judging, and I was reading about judging about sinfulness, and one of the sins is gluttony. He goes, I've never had to deal with that. I've always been able to eat all I want, and I've never put on any weight. Because I've always been as skinny as a rail without doing anything. And I look at somebody who isn't skinny, isn't thin like me, as I'm sitting there reading this article. And he goes, I began to think, maybe there's something that I'm not seeing. Maybe there's something that isn't really about whether they're overweight, but maybe it has to do with something in their background or something in their health or something in the way their body functions. And for me to say, because I'm skinny and you're not, that I'm right and you're wrong. And I read that and said, thank you. Because I can tell you, dealing with weight's not an easy thing. Dealing with illness is not easy either. And when you have an illness that puts on weight, that makes you put on weight. After I had my knee replaced, I had 3 bouts of cellulitis. That at the end of each of those, I had gained another 15 pounds, and I couldn't get it off, and I gained another 15 pounds, and I couldn't get it off, and I gained another 15 pounds. Next thing you knew, I was 45 pounds heavier, and I couldn't do a thing about it. And the more I exercised, the more the leg got bad. And the more I didn't eat, the more the nutrition went out of the way, and the more my sugar got out of whack. Finally, I said to the doctor, what am I supposed to do? He goes, go back to what you're supposed to do. Eat to live. And don't worry so much. Because when it's time, your health will take care of itself. If you're paying attention. You know, so often we can't see the other person because we have blinders on, because we have a log in our eye. Because we just don't want to see. And so we come today, and I invite you to look in the mirror. And when you look in the mirror, listen to Sammy Javis Jr. say, here come to judge, here come to judge, here come to judge. And ask that question of yourself, to whom am I judging today? Who am I putting in my radar? And how can I turn that around and turn it upside down so that I'm seeing through the lens and the eyes of God? Amen.
Thank you.
concerns, the appropriate response is listed on the screen. We will start with the concerns this morning. Yes, from Shirley Hicks, heavy on all of our hearts, I'm sure, is the situation in Ukraine. So please pray for peace in that country, pray for our leaders and all those that are affected with that situation there. This is from Cookie. She has a couple on here for Dave McCartney. Yes, for safety and fun on his escapade. He went to climb Mount Kilimanjaro and he achieved his goal. So that's wonderful for him. And then for Beth Lundeen for comfort and healing. Lord, in your mercy. And another one from Barb Palamaki for John, Vance, Stacy, and Eric, all dealing with health concerns. Lord, in your mercy. And we have some joys to share. Adam Sundberg from Jenny Quayle, wonderful. He had a successful hip surgery and is at home recovering. God is good.
All the time.
And another one from Anne-Marie Peterson for Julie Lemming's son, Nick Alderton, his wedding on Friday in Jamaica. And we are also going to pray for safe and travel for all. So God is good.
All the time.
And yep, Jackie put in a joy for Dave McCartney. Congratulations on his successful ascent of Mount Kilimanjaro. And pray for his safe return home. God is good.
All the time.
And if there's any others out there, you know, a lot of times we have some unspoken or others that people didn't get in. So, okay.
I have two things that I'd like to lift. One is that Robin wanted me to thank the congregation for those who have been praying for her and her family in the time of the death of her sister and all the cards and cares that were there. The other is that the bishop has sent a letter, and I'm not going to read the whole thing because it's about a bunch of pages long. I think it was only one page in really tiny print, but I want to read just the center part. It says, I call upon all Michigan United Methodists to pray for peace in the Ukraine at this crucial moment. I invite every United Methodist congregation in this conference to pray for peace at their weekly worship services this coming weekend and carry prayers for peace into their season of Lent, beginning with Ash Wednesday on March 2nd. If you'd like to read the whole letter, I have it here and available, but it is also on the conference website, which is michiganumc.org. It seems in these days, and I'm not going to preach, I'm just going to lift up a thought. It seems in these days that as we continue to find new ways and more ways to work and support one another, that in the midst of that, the sermon of today, that of being judgmental and wanting to see others as smaller than ourselves, continues to come up in many and different ways. And the situation in the Ukraine is one of those ways where a larger nation decides that it wants to take over a smaller one, that it may have more power in the world to make other countries look smaller so that they can feel bigger. And peace is one thing, And I agree with the bishop that we need to pray for peace. But we need to pray for a change of hearts that help us to see others, not as smaller, not as pawns, not as people we need to step over, but as people who can work alongside and lift up and help them find the hope. I was always told that a bully is somebody who feels small in themselves and wants to feel bigger by making somebody else feel smaller. And I believe that we have that situation in our world in many places. And I invite us to pray for that kind of change of heart, that all folks, all persons, countries, congregations, individuals, families, can know that they are made in the image of God and that there's only one person that we need to play to, and that is the one who created us and gives us hope. Let us be in prayer. Only God, there are so many things that we could be lifting up in prayer, so many more than we ever have time for or even know about, because it is in our world where we find that the discrepancies between people is all about self-centeredness and the desire to be bigger than somebody else. Help us to remember that you are bigger than everything, greater than, and that when we look toward you, we can find a new sense of hope, because we aren't just looking at something that is so much larger that we can't even understand the size, but that when we reach out to touch you, that you are already there holding us in your love. Surround us, O Lord, in a sense of your peace, a sense of your caring, a sense of your justice, so that as we live out our lives, we may find a new sense of hope that comes through you in your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray these words when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue with the presentation of God's tithes in our offerings. bless these gifts of tithes and offerings. Let them be for the work that you bring into our lives. Let them be a part of the work of your congregation and your kingdom here and as we prepare for it in heaven. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
I have an announcement to make. The man Shreks added a new boy to their family yesterday morning, Asher David Manshrek. He's 9 pounds, 14 ounces, and in JJ's words, the kid is huge. I know you all can hear him saying that, so good for them, number four boy. So, all right, turn to our final song.
He went walking the same old road for miles and miles. He went hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. You feel lost. He's a way maker. You need freedom. Save it.
God in your daily walk. Go now to be a follower of Christ who seeks to raise others up in everything he did